Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text this morning is the text from the Holy Gospel, and our theme this morning, following Jesus, only true disciples will. You may be seated. Dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, resolute. How many of us are resolute? Well, we just had our children down here. Maybe they are resolute in doing their homework. I don't see any mom and dad doing this, so maybe they are resolute. How about moms and dads and grandpas and grandmas? Are we resolute in ensuring that we teach our children God's Word? In ensuring that they come to Sunday school, that they hear about Jesus? How about we Christians? Are we resolute? Resolute in coming to church and being a disciple that follows Jesus all the way, even unto death itself? Are we resolute in coming here to the altar and here bowing before our Lord and receiving from Him forgiveness and life and salvation? Resolute is really a word we don't hear too much in our society today. Now, I can give you a dictionary definition. It means admirably purposeful, determined, unwavering. Well, we know that our Lord Jesus was exactly this. He was unwavering, determined, admirably purposeful in all that He did. Jesus was resolute. As we hear in our text this morning, as He left the Mount of Transfiguration, He set His face, as Isaiah tells us, His face as flint, to go to Jerusalem. And there in Jerusalem, we know what happens. But at that time, Jesus knew also what would happen. Jesus now leaves Galilee and He's traveling to Jerusalem. Yes, He's traveling to Jerusalem to die. To die for the sins of the whole world. To die for your sin and my sin. And then He would be dead and buried and rise on the third day. And 40 days later ascend into heaven. Jesus was resolute in fulfilling the plan of salvation. My dear friends, all through VBS, as we talked about being created in Christ, many times the children would ask me, but what if Jesus didn't do that? And I would always tell them, forget about the word if. Jesus did do it. It's not if, it's that He did. He did. He did. And He did it all for you. You see, Jesus knew He was about to die. Jesus had already told His disciples. He had told them not once, not twice, but three times. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. Jesus knew. He knew that He must fulfill the plan and He must do this for you and for me. As Jesus traveled along there in Samaria, He was refused hospitality. As we may remember, the Samaritans and the Jews, yes, they actually hated each other. They would refuse hospitality to each other. As a matter of fact, the Jews thought that the Samaritans was the lowest form of life, and therefore the Samaritans would they themselves refuse to have anything to do with the Jews. The point for us is that the Samaritans refused Jesus. He was rejected. So we see that the rejection of Jesus actually began even as His journey began. Refused, rejected by the Samaritans, rejected by the chief priest and the elders and the scribes. And He was even rejected by His own disciples. For there in John chapter 6, we see that many of them leave him. Ultimately, Jesus was rejected by Judas Iscariot, and then the other disciples fled from him. For as the shepherd was struck down, the sheep scattered. There was only one disciple. Only one disciple there at the cross. All the others had fled. Hospitality. My friends, this is a Christian virtue. Let's apply this hospitality to us today. As we Christians, we know that when we have visitors, we are to welcome them. We are to be hospitable to them. We are to be joyful in meeting new guests and new visitors, especially here in church. My dear friends, we must do better at this. We must always be willing to walk up to the guest and say, "Welcome to Zion. We're glad you're here." For in welcoming a visitor, as Scripture tells us, we may be very much well welcoming an angel. Yes, you see, the Lord works in ways that we can't always fathom. When we reject the visitor, when we reject the guest, what are we saying about ourselves? We are saying that we are no better than the elders or the chief priests or the scribes or the Samaritans. My friends, this is not what a Christian does. A Christian is always welcoming. A Christian is always hospitable. Because the Samaritans weren't hospitable, there were two disciples who wanted to call down fire from heaven. We know them as the sons of thunder, James and John. They sought vengeance against the Samaritans because they had tarnished the honor of their Messiah. You see, they had great zeal for Jesus, but in their great zeal, they sinned. For it's not for God's glory that Jesus came to destroy, but it's for God's glory that Jesus came to save, even the Samaritans. Jesus reminds them of his purpose, as you see there in the text. That Jesus didn't come to destroy. No, the Son of God came to seek and to save the lost. He came to seek you. He came to save you. He did not come to destroy us. So what does Jesus do? He turns to his disciples and he looks them in the eye and he rebukes them. As he did Peter. As he did the Pharisees. As he did anyone who attempt him not to go to the cross. You see, my dear friends, a disciple of Jesus, and we all know the definition of a disciple is one who is a learner, one who is following Jesus. All of us here this morning, we are disciples of Jesus. We are here learning, and we are followers of our Lord Jesus. So therefore, Jesus tells us that his disciples, that they must have the Spirit of God. And what is that Spirit? You heard it this morning in the epistle. We are to have the fruits of faith. Joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are the fruits of the Spirit. These are what a Christian is. If a Christian doesn't have any of these, once again, we are no different than the pagan. We are no different than the unbeliever. We are then rightfully rebuked. Where Jesus tells us that if we don't have the fruits of the Spirit, if we aren't hospitable, if we are not full of grace and truth and mercy and love, then we can't be his disciple. You see, Jesus' disciples are to do what the Lord does. If we are to follow him, we are to follow his example. If we are to follow him, we are to cleave to him. We are to follow him. Even if it means that we ourselves are put to death. And yes, we see this in the Middle East today. There are Christians who are being beheaded because they refuse to let go of Jesus. They'd rather die with Jesus And in their death, they live with Jesus. It's no doubt, my friends, that we face opposition in this world, just as Jesus faced opposition. He said it would happen. He said that since the Son of Man will suffer, we too will suffer, and it's obvious that we do. What is a disciple to do then? What are we as disciples to do? Well, Jesus gives us three examples this morning. So let's talk about those three examples. It's kind of a second homily, if you will. We've just heard about opposition, about Jesus going to save us, what a disciple is. So now let's talk about discipleship. The first example, there's a man who wants to follow Jesus, even if it means death, for that's what the word follow means in the original language, that he will cleave to Jesus, even if it means he must die. Yes, a true disciple must be willing to lose all. A true disciple must be willing to leave home, to have no permanent shelter. Unlike the animals, for Jesus tells the man, the son of even the foxes and the holes, even the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. You see, a disciple is about to be about kingdom work. And that may mean that we as a disciple may have no place to lay our head. We may have no safety in this world. We may have no shelter. Yet, we know that we do have shelter in our Lord Jesus. You see, kingdom work, dear ones, is far more important than a fancy home, a fancy car or truck, or even fancy clothes. Heavenly work is far more important than earthly pleasures and earthly treasures. And this is what Jesus is getting across to the first disciple. But he doesn't stop there. There is the second disciple. And this second disciple is called by Jesus. Jesus tells him, follow me. He says the same thing to us. We are to follow him. But the second man is no different than us. He has an excuse. Dear ones, your pastor had made excuses for many, many years. When I was in high school, yes, I really wanted to be a pastor. But then things happened in my life, and I realized that I wanted to have fun, to eat, drink, and make merry. So for about 30 years, I made excuse after excuse after excuse. No different than the second disciple here. The man's excuse is that he wants to wait until his father dies so that he can bury him. He wants to be a good son. Yet Jesus tells him, let the dead bury the dead, but you come follow me and proclaim the word of God. You come and follow me and proclaim the word of the kingdom. The man wasn't willing because he had other things to do rather than to cleave to Jesus and follow him. So is it your desire really? Is it really your desire to follow Jesus? Or would you rather allow human relationships and earthly pleasures and treasures keep you from following him? Following Jesus requires a wholehearted, undivided attention for the Word, for the Gospel, for the Savior himself. There can be no other distractions. And this comes really pointed with the third man. The third man, he also wants to follow Jesus. He raises his hand and volunteers. But, oh, there's that word but. We talked about it in adult Bible class. It means that two statements are equally true. For your pastor, when I hear you say the word but, I raise a red flag because I'm thinking what you've just said, you're going to negate because you really don't believe it. What you're about to say is what you really feel. So the man says, but I have to go home and say goodbye to my family. What's Jesus' response? No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Well, farmers and here in the congregation, let's talk about plowing. Nowadays, plowing's pretty easy, isn't it? You just hop in your John Deere, set your GPS, and off you go. But back then, it was a single blade plow, a wooden plow, yoked to a team of oxen. And the farmer had to use his left hand to put his hand on the handle of that plow, to push it into the ground. And in his right hand, he had to carry a goad to ensure that the oxen kept moving and to ensure that they kept going in a straight line. So can you imagine a farmer who's plowing like this? It won't work. The oxen will go one way or the other way, and the plow will be a horrible mess. Jesus is telling us, if we truly want to follow him, we must be resolute. We must put our hand on the plow of the gospel and never let go and always look forward. For when we're looking back, then we become unfit. When we're looking back at our hometown, looking back at our family or friends, looking back at our earthly treasures and pleasures, we're no longer fit to be a disciple of our Lord Jesus. We're no longer fit to proclaim the good news. And your pastor was there one time. I thought my hand was on the plow, but I was looking back. And then the Lord made me fit by bringing a trial into my life. And in that trial, I realized that there's only one way, and it's not my way. It's always his way. Yes, following Jesus, it's not an easy road. But my dear friends, yes, we may be convicted by the law. We may hear. We may be convicted this morning that, yes, maybe I haven't been following Jesus as he tells me to follow him. Yes, it's obvious to us that we're all sinners and that we will be tempted to follow the ways of this world, the treasures and pleasures. We know ultimately that they lead to death. But also know this, Jesus went to the cross. Jesus was the one who was resolute. Jesus was the one who was not looking back. It was Jesus who left his home in heaven and came down to the earth. And it was Jesus who set his face resolutely to go to the cross for you and for me. And there at the cross, all your sin was washed away by the blood of the Lamb. All your sin is forgiven. All your sin was forgiven because Jesus, he is the dutiful son. It is Jesus who has fulfilled this scripture. And it is Jesus who has opened the kingdom of heaven to you and to me. And it is Jesus who still calls us to be his disciples. Yes, he knows. He knows that we will make excuses. He knows that we will put our hand in the plow, then we'll be tempted to look back. He knows we'll do this, but he also knows. He also knows that when we confess our sins and repent of our sins, we know and he knows that our sins are forgiven. For the word is true. For the Lord is faithful and he is just. And he will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus, follow him. Follow him all the way into the kingdom. And that's what a true disciple does. Jesus has opened the kingdom of heaven to all of us because he is the true disciple who followed the plan of his Father and fulfilled the plan perfectly for you, and for you. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus now and forever. Amen.